Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I want to talk about Unity builds, what they are, how they might help your code, and what they do. Now, of course, before I continue, I would like to remind you that I am available for contracting and on-site training, and that I have several puzzle books and best practices books and t-shirts and other swag available in the video description. Okay, so it's possible you've heard about Unity builds, and they are common enough that we even have official CMake support for them. All right, so here is the general idea. You've got, presumably, a bunch of files in your program. And you compile all these things, one, two, three, you compile them one at a time. And depending on how many CPUs you have to go through, it's possible that you might have to build them all in a sequential fashion, for example. Now, let's just say for the argument that you've got two CPUs in your computer. And that's just going to be to simplify the example that I'm trying to draw here. Now, if you have two CPUs in your computer, you might be able to compile these two, and then these two, and then these two, and then these two. And what that means is for each one of these things, you have to like reparse all of your header files and includes and all of this stuff. Now, what a Unity build does is it takes chunks of files and it merges them. It literally concatenates a bunch of files together and then compiles them. So in this particular example, I'm going to have exactly two files to compile. Now, this has lots of pros and some caveats and cons. So let's just go ahead and show you what this looks like from an actual CMake perspective. In an actual real-world project that I was just testing this with the other day. Okay, so this is a project that I have been tangentially involved with for a while now. It's an open source project that I was a contractor on for some time. So I'm using it as an example to see if I can speed up build times. And I've taken kind of the heavy-handed big global approach here, but it turns out that this is actually more what is recommended by the CMake documentation. I am globally setting CMake Unity build to true, and I'm saying I want you to do Unity builds for all of the targets in this project. Now, not all of the projects can actually compile with Unity builds, so I then have to go in through a few of these and say, the expat library, I want you to explicitly turn off Unity builds for it. And now this is actually a recommended thing to do from the CMake docs. If you know that your project cannot compile with Unity builds, then you should go ahead and set this property for the target for your project, so that when someone else is consuming your library, as we are here, then we know, oh, it'll automatically disable Unity builds for this third-party dependency that I'm compiling, and still use Unity builds for my project if I want it to. So I had to go through and selectively disable Unity builds in 4, 5 of the 6 of the dependent targets in here. And that was all it took. Now, when I reconfigure CMake and I compile from here, the compiler is going to generate a bunch of targets for us. And let's see if we can find those real quick. Okay, you can see here while it's compiling that it has this Unity subfolder, and it is compiling this Unity_8_CXX.CXX.O. So it's creating this one object file in this Unity build. So see all of these CXX and these .o files. This project has like 500 C++ files, something like that in it. And CMake went ahead and automatically glommed these things together into these large Unity files. So let's just pull up one of them. And you can see here that it did this pound include of each C++ file. That might be a little scary to you, but let's go ahead and look at the end results here. I'm going to go ahead and just show you the raw data that I have on the GitHub issue about this particular episode. Now, just as a reminder, you can go to Lefticus/CPPWeekly and you can look at all the upcoming planned episodes and comment on them yourselves. This is the layout here. We've got many C++ files that are merged into one file before compilation. Now, the theory is that this will improve compile time and possibly improve runtime. And that is because our compiler has greater cross-translation unit visibility than it used to, kind of like enabling link time optimization. The downside, or we could argue is perhaps another upside, is that all ODR violations now become compile errors. This is a one definition rule. If you have a one definition rule violation, which I don't really have time to go into in depth here, but the idea is if you have more than one definition of the same function or object, that is undefined behavior explicitly stated in the standard. So we turn on this build, and I want to run through a couple of numbers here. Now, first of all, this is using the mold linker, which we'll talk about in a future episode. And I've got 14 minutes and 49 seconds, and a performance run that I ran took 40 seconds to run. And let's take a quick look at this binary size. This is almost 70 megabytes. So this is our original mold build. Now I am going to look at the mold Unity build data. It is 9 minutes and 37 seconds. This is down over 30% from the baseline build. This is just enabling Unity. CPU utilization went down slightly, and the performance run stayed almost exactly the same. So we did not get a performance gain from doing this. But interestingly, file size was actually down by about 1 megabyte. And I haven't gone and looked exactly into why that was the case. Let's look at, again, this time, this is 14 minutes and 48 seconds. Now, link time optimization pushes more of the work to link time that was at compile time. And theoretically, link time builds are slower because you have this bottleneck of linking. Now, I'm not going to say this is going to hold true for your project, but for the sake of this project that I'm testing here, I did a plain build, nothing fancy, and have compared that also to a link time optimization with Unity builds enabled. And at that point, I got a, this is the mold Unity LTO build, 7 minutes and 26 seconds. So that is literally 2 times faster than our previous builds, and this is for release builds. Now, you might notice that I got reduced CPU utilization overall, and that is because apparently linking is not terribly expensive on this particular project. And all along the way, our performance run that we were testing against stayed almost exactly the same, but the file size went down by another 7 megabytes. So let's go back up to the conclusions here. On this particular project, I saw zero performance differences with the Unity build, but I did ultimately manage to sneak out a 2 times faster build when I combined Unity with link time optimization in this project. Now, I did have one particular problem where I had two C++ files that were defining macros with the same name, and I was getting a warning saying that this macro has been redefined. That, in my opinion, should have been an error because I have no idea what the downstream impact that might have been on having that macro defined. So Unity builds are tricky to get right. If I was going to perhaps give you a best practice here, something like this. You should probably test your project semi-regularly with Unity builds to know if you've got ODR violations across object files. And again, this is something that LTO can also help you find. Unity plus LTO seems to be a very powerful combination for this particular project that I am looking at. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something new. Be sure to comment if you have used Unity builds. I know this has been common for a long time in the games industry, but it is less common in the rest of the world. And having official support in CMake for this definitely lowers the barrier to entry here. And there's, of course, flags that you can use to tweak that. So again, thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly.